Jordan River.
Church, and welcome, friends. What another wonderful, wonderful day for God's people everywhere to come together as a family, one body of believers, to worship Him in spirit and in truth. Truly a beautiful day that the Lord has given us, friends. Psalm 122 says, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord just to give thanks to the name of the Lord. And I believe it is also a good reason for us to be here today. Friends, I am Evangelist Davis Worley, and on behalf of the saints who worship in Sandtown, West Baltimore, Maryland, I pray the peace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ upon you all, and I bid you greetings. We welcome you, friends, to our worship once again via live stream. It is our absolute pleasure to invite you into our worship service. We are absolutely delighted that you have chosen to spend just a few moments of your time with us today. Friends, we know that there are many other things that you could be doing, but God placed it on your heart to visit with us. And while we would have preferred to be with you in person, we are thankful for your interest and your desire to worship with us. Friends, churches of Christ all around the world are modifying how they worship due to the coronavirus. Friends, this threat is still very, very real. It is still very real, and we all must take it seriously. So it is wise that we take the necessary precautions to protect ourselves against becoming infected, but also that we do not unknowingly endanger the lives of others. So until such time, friends, that we can assemble ourselves together, we, the Church of Christ in Sandtown, West Baltimore, Maryland, will continue to worship God in spirit and in truth by social media stream and other means that are available to us. Friends, we are determined to give God the praise that He and only He so rightfully deserves. And we plan to do this by any means necessary. Friends, we know that our God is great and worthy to be praised. Besides Him, there are no other gods. We're determined to honor Him as we have been taught by example of those before us, according to Acts chapter number 20, verse number 7, and 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verses 1 and 2, upon the first day of the week. Friends, our love for Jesus keeps us strong, encouraged, uplifted, and focused on praising Him no matter the obstacles, viruses, germs, disease, pestilence, or unreliability of men. Friends, we know that our God is a conqueror. He's a shield. He's a defender. He's a comforter. He's a strong defense, a fortress, a mighty warrior. He's King of kings and Lord of lords. He hears the cry of His children, and He comes to our defense. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse number 12 tells us that the eyes, my friends, the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and His ears are open to our prayers. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Friends, our God has never, ever lost a battle. And He never, ever will. Friends, let's pray together. The Lord our God and our Father, holy and eternal in heaven, all-powerful, almighty, and righteous, all-loving, filled with compassion, grace, and mercy. Father, we humble ourselves beneath your throne of grace on today, thanking you, Father, for today. Thank you, Father, for allowing us to rise on this morning, Father. And Father, we thank you because we know that today was not promised to us. We are only here, Father, because you have allowed it to be so. And Father, we recognize that many laid their heads on their pillows last night with thoughts for today. But they didn't open their eyes, Father. You called them home. So we thank you, Father, for granting us yet one more day. A day in which we can assemble ourselves together to praise you, to glorify you, Father, to honor you. Because you alone are deserving of our praise. And Father, we come now admitting that we have sinned, Father. We've had thoughts, we've said something, we've done something that is not pleasing in your sight. And we humbly ask now, dear Lord, that you would please do as you have promised us in your word. If we repent of our sins, Father, you'll be just to forgive us and remember our sins no more. Father, we thank you for being such a loving God, a forgiving God, a God who favors us and wants only the best for us. Father, please help us, your children, to walk with joy, with gladness, Father, with dignity and honor in the privileges that you have bestowed upon us, Father. Help us to share all of our many rich blessings, dear Lord God, with those around us. Help us, Father, as we continue to strive, Father, to bring lost souls to your Son, Jesus. Father, bless us each and every one. You know what we stand in need of, Father. We're simply asking that you would continue to meet our needs. And Father, we're asking that you would bless this world, each and every citizen. Bless everyone, Father, from the poor man to the rich man, from the humble to the hardy, Father. Bless us each and every one. Help us, Father, to love one another as you love us. Help us to be compassionate among ourselves, Father. Help us to do as you have taught us in your word, Father, to esteem others greater than ourselves. Help us, Father, to look out for the interest of others rather than ourselves. Bless the leadership all around this world, Father. Help them to understand how important it is that they get along in one accord with one another. Help them to understand, Father, the great responsibility that has been given and entrusted to them through you. Help them, Father, to lead their people in a way that is pleasing in your sight. And Father, we ask that you would bless those who are in mourning, dear Lord God, for whatever the reason. And help us, your children, to demonstrate your love and your compassion with our neighbors. Father, bless us as we continue in this worship. We pray, dear Lord God, that the things that we say and the things that we do here on today will rise unto you a sweet smelling aroma, pleasing and acceptable in your sight. Father, be with us. Allow your spirit to rest upon us and guide us where you would have us to go. In Jesus' most holy and precious name, we do humbly pray. Amen. Friends, welcome to the Church of Christ. Relax, be at ease, be comforted, and find peace for your troubled soul. Friends, please join us now as we worship God in congregational singing with song leaders from all over the Church of Christ as we lift up our voices in holy praise to God in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs.
I woke up this morning with my
Amen. Oh Lord, oh Lord, oh Lord, let me travel in the light that I may see the blessing. Lord, would you please keep me that I may be holy and sing redemption songs someday. For I will be a soldier brave and never firmly take a stand, Lord. And as I onward go, and I daily meet the foe, blessed Jesus, hold my hand. I need you, Lord, I'm singing, blessed Jesus, hold my hand. For I need every hour while I'm traveling through this. Give my feet a free.
Welcome once again, friends. So happy to have you here. If you have your copy of God's Word, we want you to open it to Romans chapter number 7, the book of Romans chapter number 7. If you don't have your copy of God's Word, we want you to go ahead and lay hands on it. Look around, find it. We want you to break it open Read along with me at home as I read to you aloud. So get your Bibles. Get your Bibles. Friends, this morning I will be reading from the book of Romans, chapter number 7, verses 15 through 20. The book of Romans, chapter number 7, verses 15 through 20. And I'm reading from the New King James Version. And the scripture reads, "For what I am doing, I do not understand. For what I will to do, that I do not practice. But what I hate, that I do. If, then, I do what I will not to do, I agree with the law that it is good. But now it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells in me. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, nothing good dwells. For to will is present with me. But how to perform what is good, I do not find. For the good that I will to do, I do not do. But the evil I will not to do, that I practice. Now if I do what I will not to do, it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells in me." May the Lord add a blessing to the hearing, to the reading of his word, but most importantly to those who obey his word. Friends, let's pray together once again. The Lord our God and our Father, most holy and eternal in heaven, the God of all creation, the God of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who makes all things possible for us with you. Father, we humble ourselves once again beneath your throne of grace on today. Just again, Father, thanking you for today, Father, and for your many rich blessings that you have bestowed upon us. And Father, we pray for your word as it will go forth. We're praying, Father, for all who are in our listening and viewing audience, dear Lord God, that something will be said to prick their hearts, to open their understanding, Father, and cause them to ask that faithful question, what must I do to be saved? Father, please allow your spirit to continue to rest upon us. And as always, Father, guide us where you would have us to go. It is in Jesus' most holy and precious name that we do humbly pray. Amen.
Lord, 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 I want you to help me. Say, Lord, 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 I want you to help me. Say, won't you help me on my way? Yeah, Lord,
help me on my way.
I said, please, please. Sometimes you gotta say, please.
Lord,
I'm as tall as the bear. Say, Lord, you always bring that bear.
Lord, help me.
And I just can't make it without you, Lord.
Help me.
Good morning, church, and welcome, friends. As the old preacher once said, I'm not going to hold you long, but for the next few minutes, I am going to try to hold you strong. Friends, we're living in a time where people are struggling with morality. More and more, we're seeing persuasive images on TV and in social media designed to influence our thoughts, coerce us to embrace certain behaviors, and change our principles, values, and ethics. The influence of social media is powerful by itself. But when celebrities and other influential people that we respect and our children admire use and are used by social media to endorse a particular cause or ideology, it gives the perception of credibility, even to disingenuous positions, which makes it more difficult to determine what's right and what is wrong. Friends, the power of influencers is so strong that our children today will believe them over their own parents. I'm doing more fact-checking now than at any other time in my life. Why? Because I want my children to know the truth about what they're being told so that they'll make the right choice based on facts, not opinion, exaggeration, sensationalism, or embellished assertions. I don't want them to go along to get along. I want them to know what's right and do what's right because it's right. Deception is a science and tactic of Satan that he uses to keep us confused and cause us to question truth. Truth, friends, is being manipulated, distorted, and revised right before our eyes. And if we're not attentive, many of us will get sucked into the transformative, chaotic vortex of Satan, where truth is ridiculed and rejected, and lies, false propaganda, and deception are embraced and normalized. Thus, my topic this morning is a plea for you to do the right thing. Do the right thing. Friends, today I'm going to make 3 points, just 3 quick points, and the message will be yours. And friends, if you're worshiping with us on this morning, we want to thank you. We appreciate your presence with us this morning. But we want you to do us a favor. We want you to grab yourself a pen or a pencil. Get yourself a sheet of paper. We want you to follow along with us this morning. We want you to take copious notes. We want you to check us out and see if the things that we preach and the things that we teach are what thus saith the Lord. So friends, if you're writing this down on this morning, 3 quick points I want to make. Number one, the struggle is real. The struggle is real, my friends. Number two, we must acknowledge our faults. We must acknowledge our faults. And number three, you are not helpless. You are not helpless. So to my first points, friends, the struggle is real. The struggle is real. There's a memorable dialogue in a movie. Most of you probably remember this movie, A Few Good Men, wherein a witness under examination in a murder trial defiantly tells a prosecuting attorney, "You can't handle the truth." He knew that if he told the truth, it would reveal the true nature of those involved and expose a culture that gave rise to a horrific crime. And he was right. Friends, many of us today, both young and old, can't handle hearing the truth about ourselves. Something about the truth scares us and makes us resent the messenger of truth. We all have issues that we don't want to talk about or deal with. So rather than dealing with our problems, many of us suppress them. We conclude that if we don't acknowledge the problem, if we just ignore it, that it doesn't exist. Why? Because we can't handle the truth. Friends, life is real. Our problems are real, and they require a real response. Suppressing our problems doesn't make them go away. At some point, we must deal with them, or they'll cause us anxiety and severe psychological damage. In our scripture reading, Romans chapter 7, verses 15 through 20, the Apostle Paul reveals that his anxieties and struggles with the flesh were caused by sin. The major conflict for Paul was determining how to reconcile his extensive knowledge of the law of Moses with his true nature. The holy rule of God made Paul realize that he too had imperfections and a proclivity to sin. And he assessed that his anxiety was due in part because he understood God's law. Yet, he repeatedly failed to keep God's commandments. So after careful examination of himself, Paul dissected the conflict between his spiritual nature and his sinful nature, the flesh. And he reasoned that his spiritual nature was incapable of committing sin, but rather his disobedience to God's law was caused by sin dwelling in his flesh. It was his flesh or human nature that was dominated by sin and that defied God's righteousness. Friends, with each sin, the flesh wars against the spirit. The flesh wars against the spirit. And Paul, not excusing his conduct, held himself accountable for his actions by acknowledging his role in not controlling his impulses to sin, thus allowing sin to have dominion over his flesh. And in verse 15 of our scripture reading, Paul acknowledges his struggle with the flesh. He says, "For what I am doing, I do not understand. For what I will to do, that I do not practice. But what I hate, that I do." Friends, Paul sounds like a man with a bad habit that he just can't break. He said, "I don't understand myself. I want to do what's right, but I don't. Instead, I do the very thing I hate." Paul couldn't do the right thing. Whatever he was struggling with was real. It overwhelmed him and had him bound. He hated what he was doing, but he couldn't resist the temptation to sin. He was overcome, fixated by this thing, whatever it was, and couldn't break free from it. And like Paul, many of us struggle with sin every day. We have real issues that weigh heavily on us. We go to bed struggling with our problems, and we wake up only to continue the struggle. The harder we fight, the more sin seems to tighten its grip on us. For many of us, the struggle is real. The struggle is real. When you find yourself doing things that you don't understand, you know it's real. When you do things that embarrass you and your family, you know it's real. When you do things that keep you awake at night, you know it's real. When you do things that keep you looking over your shoulder, you know it's real. When you go into hiding because of what you've done, you know it's real. When you take chances that could send you to prison for the rest of your life, you know it's real. When you lose everything you own because you're not living right, you know it's real. When your health begins to fail because of your lifestyle, you know it's real. When you want to stop what you're doing, but you can't, you know it's real. When you do things that jeopardize your life and the lives of those you love, oh, you know it's real. When your friends and family turn their backs on you because of what you're doing, you know it's real. When mama tells you not to come around her anymore because of what you're doing, oh, it's very real. When you know what you're doing is wrong, but you still do it, you know it's real. When people want to kill you because of what you're doing, you know it's real. When you've done things that make you hate yourself, oh, you know it's real. When you want to give up on yourself, you know it's real. When your conduct starts driving you out of your mind, you know it's real. Some of us have been there. We've had some real problems. Some of us are still dealing with things. Our struggle is real. In verse 16 of our scripture reading, Paul says, "If then I do what I will not to do, I agree that the law is good." Friends, we got to understand this part. The Apostle Paul knew the law. He knew the law. He studied and learned from the best instructors among the children of Israel. He was a law scholar. In fact, he boasted in his knowledge and understanding of the law. If you look over in the book of Acts, chapter 22, around verse number 3, as Paul defended himself before a mob of Jews seeking to destroy him, he said, "I am indeed a Jew, born in Tarsus, a city in Cilicia. I was brought up in this city and educated at the feet of Gamaliel. As his student, I was carefully taught and trained according to the strictness of our father's law, and was zealous toward God, as you all are today." And in Philippians chapter 3, verses 4 through 6, if you look there, the Apostle Paul reminded the Philippian saints of his pedigree. He said, "Though I also might have confidence in the flesh, if anyone thinks he may have confidence in the flesh, I more so, no one more than me." He says, "I was circumcised at 8 days old of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin." Paul said, "I was a Hebrew of the Hebrews. Concerning the law, a Pharisee. Concerning zeal, I persecuted the Lord's church. Concerning righteousness, which is in the law, I was blameless." Paul said, "Check my pedigree. I'm a pure-blooded citizen of Israel, a member of the tribe of Benjamin. I know my roots." He says, "I'm a real Hebrew if ever there was one." He said, "I was a member of the Pharisees who demanded strict obedience to Jewish law." Paul said, "I was so zealous that I persecuted the Lord's church. As for righteousness, I obeyed the law without fault." Friends, Paul knew the law. He was indoctrinated into the law from birth, and he understood why it was given. And he was struggling with sin because he understood the law. Paul knew that the law convicts us of sin. In our scripture reading, Romans chapter 7, just look up at verse number 7. There Paul says, what shall we say then? Is the law sin? Certainly not. On the contrary, I would not have known sin except through the law. Drop down, look at verse number 8. There Paul says, apart from the law, sin was dead. And if you look over in Galatians chapter 3, verse number 19, there the Apostle Paul tells us the law was given alongside the promise to show people their sins. The law magnified Paul's sins and revealed to him that he was not doing the right thing. It exposed his fleshly nature and made him aware of his sins. And friends, many of us today are struggling because we are not doing the right thing. Sin is convicting you in the flesh because you're resisting God's laws and avoiding his warnings to obey his word. Friends, if you think you can live however you want without consequence for your actions, you are only deceiving yourselves. All of us, every human, must obey one law, God's law. God's law applies to saints and sinners, Christians and non-believers, rich and poor, kings, queens, presidents, politicians, it doesn't matter who you are. God's laws apply to you. There's no getting around it. No going under it. And no going over it. You may have your own philosophy on life and try to establish your own rules. You may not believe in God. You may have even created your own form of religion, as so many do. But my friends, here's a news flash. No human or spiritual creature can live according to his own rules apart from God's laws without consequence. It's not going to happen. You look over in the book of Romans, chapter number 2. Romans chapter 2, look at verses 12 through 16. There, the Apostle Paul tells us that as many as have sinned without law will also perish without law. Go ahead on, make up your own laws. You're still going to be held accountable. Paul says, as many as have sinned in the law will be judged by the law. He says, for not the hearers of the law are just in the sight of God, but the doers of the law will be justified. For when Gentiles, here it is, who do not have the law, by nature do the things that are in the law. These, although not having the law, are a law to themselves. Your nature is going to hold you accountable. Paul says, who show the work of the law written in their hearts. The conscience, also bearing witness, and between themselves their thoughts, accusing or excusing them in the day when God will judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ according to the gospel. My friends, every man has a conscience. It lets us know that we're breaking God's laws. It was given to us to let us know when we're doing the right thing and to warn us when we're not doing the right thing. Friends, God's law is supreme. And every man, whether saved or unsaved, or spiritual creature, will be held accountable according to God's laws. Friends, the struggle is real. Which brings me to my second point. We must acknowledge our sins. Friends, we must acknowledge our sins. We cannot deal with our sin problem if we do not acknowledge our sins. In our scripture reading, Romans chapter 7, verses 17 through 20, the Apostle Paul's behavior had him struggling to understand his actions. So he acknowledged that he had a sin problem. Paul said, "It is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells in me. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, nothing good dwells. For to will, I want to do what's right." He says, "For to will is present with me. But how to perform what is good, I do not find. For the good that I will to do, I do not do. But the evil I will not to do, that I practice. Now if I do what I will not to do, it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells in me." Friends, Paul acknowledges his sins. He says, "I'm not the one doing wrong. It's sin dwelling in me. It's my sinful nature. I want to do what's right, but I can't. I want to do what's good, but I don't. I don't want to do what's wrong, but I do it anyway. Help us, Lord." Friends, sin was causing Paul to act against his spiritual nature. And many of us feel just like Paul today. We know what's right, but we're struggling to do the right thing. We want to do what's right, but we can't. Something keeps preventing us, pulling us away from the straight and righteous path, leading us down the forbidden path of destruction. We want to do what's good, but we don't. We're confused. Something has convinced us that bad is good. Help us, Lord. We try to resist the temptation to do wrong, but thoughts of pleasure entice us to do it anyway. We wonder, is there something wrong with me? Am I depraved? Do I have a mental deficiency? No. No, friends. You have a sin deficiency. Your sinful nature is controlling you. Friends, sin is habit forming. Sin is habit forming. It causes us to behave, say, and do things that we wouldn't normally do. Because we're creatures of habit, we do things that we enjoy, things that give us pleasure. The problem many of us have is that the things that give us pleasure are sinful things. The more we do them, the more we want to do them. And the cycle continues. Friends, there's a saying that if you keep doing the same thing, you'll keep getting the same result. Every time we sin, the result is more sin. It's a vicious cycle that we can't break unless, like Paul, we acknowledge that we have a sin problem. Nothing will change until you determine to do something different. No one ever fixes anything that they don't think is broken. Sin has broken many of us. We're crumbling into pieces, but we refuse to acknowledge it. Ladies, I'm not picking on you. I'm not picking on you, ladies. But I've seen many of you wear clothing that just doesn't compliment you well. Just doesn't compliment you well. Some stuff should remain in your closet or be given away. They don't enhance your beauty the way you think they do. In your mind, you may be thinking, oh, this makes me look good. But others who see you may be wondering, what was she thinking? Why did she wear that? You don't see the problem because you don't want to acknowledge there is a problem. But others see it. Friends, this is an example of how our sin problem affects us. Sometimes we don't acknowledge what others see in us. Things that don't look good or are problematic. Things that we need to change, but we ignore. If we never acknowledge that we have a sin problem, we'll never address it. And if we never address it, we'll never fix it. Our sins will remain with us. Friends, Paul's struggle with sin really had him frantically trying to solve his problem. Paul believed in salvation. And because he knew God's word, he understood that sin separates us from God. The prophet Isaiah said in Isaiah chapter 59, verse number 2, your iniquities separate you from your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you. And Jesus said in John chapter 8, verse number 21, if you die in your sin, where he is, you cannot come. Friends, Paul's understanding of God's word prompted him to keep it real with himself. He kept it real with himself. And we should learn from Paul. Friends, don't deceive yourselves. No sinners will be in heaven. No sinners will be in heaven. Being separated from God and Christ should have all of us in crisis mode, frantically trying to remove our sins. To be saved from sin, we must first acknowledge it in our lives, then determine to do something about it. If we look at the book of Romans, chapter 6, the book of Romans, chapter 6, go down to verses 12 and 13. There the Apostle Paul tells us not to allow sin to reign in our mortal body, the flesh, that we should obey it in its lusts, and not to present our members as instruments of unrighteousness to sin. Free yourself from sin. Get rid of it. Don't let sin control the way you live. If you do, it will determine your eternal resting place. Romans chapter 6, verse 16 warns us that to whom you present yourselves slaves to obey, you are that one slave whom you obey, whether of sin leading to death or of obedience leading to righteousness. And if you look at verse number 23, verse 23 makes it clear to us that the wages of sin is death. Do the right thing. Do the right thing. Choose righteousness. Acknowledge your sins and get rid of your sins while you have the opportunity. So to my final point. Friends, there's good news. There's good news today. You're not helpless against sin. You're not helpless against sin. In verse 24 of our scripture reading, the Apostle Paul sounds helpless. He sounds lost and without hope, trapped in his body of sin. Paul asks a question in verse 24. Oh, wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? Friends, like the Apostle Paul, we all should be asking ourselves this same question. Temptation is common to all of us. The temptations in your life are no different from what others experience. We're all tempted to sin. But like Paul, we must seek help in removing our sins. Sin is the dirt of this world, the unspiritual filth that God sees and despises when he looks at us. It separates us from God now and eternally if we do not have it removed. We can't shower it away, we can't bathe or scrub it away, and we can't pray it away, friends. There's nothing that we can do on our own to remove our sins. Like Paul, we must realize the hope we have in Jesus. Thank you, Lord. In verse 25 of our scripture reading, if you look there, the Apostle Paul says, I thank God through Christ Jesus our Lord. Paul realizes that in Jesus, he isn't helpless. And neither are we. Friends, God is for us. He sent his son, Jesus, to redeem us, free us from the bonds of sin. He raised Jesus from the grave for us. Praise be to God for loving us in spite of our miserable, unclean selves. Romans chapter 5, verse 8 tells us that God demonstrates his own love toward us and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Thank you, Lord. God sent his son, Jesus, to help us combat and remove our sins. Jesus gives us the victory over sin. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 56 and 57. There the Apostle Paul tells us the sting of death is sin. And the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God. Thank you, Lord, who gives us the victory through Christ Jesus our Lord. Praise God for giving us the help and the hope we need. Friends, many of you may be feeling the same way Paul did. You may be thinking there's no help and no hope for your sin problem. But praise God that in all these things, we are more than conquerors because God loves us. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse number 13 tells us that we have a God who is faithful and he won't allow us to be tempted beyond what we're able to bear. But with the temptation, he'll make a way of escape that we may be able to bear it. Thank you, Lord. Friends, I want you to know today that in Jesus, we have a way to escape the temptation to sin. He's our hope when we're hopeless. He's a way maker when we can't see our way. He's our strength when we're weak. When we have problems, he's our problem solver. In fact, he told us to bring all of our problems to him. He said, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. He's a present help in times of trouble. He's always right here with us. He promised us that he will never leave us nor forsake us. Friends, we have a reason to hope and have joy today. You may be struggling, but it won't last always. Joy is coming in the morning. Hold on to the promises of God. Lean on him and not on your own understanding. Like the Apostle Paul, friends, none of us can resist the temptation to sin on our own. If we could, we wouldn't sin. And we wouldn't need Jesus. God has provided our help through Jesus. As long as we have Jesus, we have help. And we have a reason to hope today. Jesus removes our sin problem. Do the right thing today. Establish a relationship with Jesus. 1 John chapter 1, if you look there. 1 John chapter 1 verse 7 tells us that if we have a relationship with Jesus, he'll take care of our sin problem. John says if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all sin. Thank you, Lord. Friends, you can find help in your struggle with sin today if you simply do the right thing. Do the right thing. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus today. I want to leave you with this thought that the Apostle James gives us in James chapter 4. If you look there, James chapter 4, verse number 17. There the Apostle James tells us, therefore to him who knows to do good and does not do it, to him it is sin. Friends, the right thing to do today is to come to Jesus and have your sins removed. Just do the right thing. Do the right thing. That's my message on this morning. Friends, you can stop struggling today simply by doing the right thing and have your sins removed. Believe the gospel that Jesus is the Son of God. He came to earth, died for our sins. Why? Jesus says in John chapter 8, verse number 24, you will die in your sins if you do not believe that he is the Son of God. Friends, you must repent of your sins, which simply means you make up your mind right now that you want to live right before God. You want to do the right thing. Why? Because Jesus said in Luke chapter 13, verse number 3, I tell you no, but unless you repent, you will all likewise perish. Friends, you must confess that you believe Jesus is the Son of God. Why? Because Romans chapter number 10, verses 9 and 10 tells us that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart, one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. And finally, friends, according to Acts chapter number 2, verse number 38, you must be baptized. You must be baptized, which is a total bodily submersion in water, in the name of Jesus, for the forgiveness of your sins. And you shall, my friends, you shall receive the precious gift of the Holy Spirit. you rise from that water a new creature in Christ, having made the proper exchange, death for life, giving all your struggles to Jesus. Friends, please notice the numbers that are scrolling at the bottom of the screen. Notice the numbers. Notice the email address. Friends, we want you to call, text, or email us right now. This very moment, right now. Our operators are standing by. If you desire that we pray for you, call us, text us, email us, leave us your name and number. Don't allow this opportunity to pass you by. We want to help you do the right thing today. It will save your soul. Friends, on behalf of the Church of Christ in Sandtown, West Baltimore, Maryland, I'd like to thank the many churches of Christ that supported our worship today and thank you for joining us. Friends, if you would like a personal Bible study or have any questions, friends, any questions about anything you heard today, contact information for the Church of Christ in Sandtown and other churches of Christ in your area will be displayed at the end of this live stream. And friends, as always, we encourage you to visit a Church of Christ near you. Please visit a Church of Christ near you and you tell them that Brother Worley sent you. And friends, if you would like to support our mission here in Sandtown, West Baltimore, Maryland, please note our GoFundMe page and Cash App, and you can make your contributions there. Friends, we encourage you and the churches of Christ all over the world to keep the faith. Don't give up hope and know that God is willing and able to do all things. Friends, I am Evangelist Davis Worley, and until we meet again, God bless, keep and comfort you and reveal the truth in his word that it might open your understanding and cause you to consider your relationship with God and Christ before it is eternally too late. Be blessed and be safe, my friends.
I know Mama loves. I know.
Jesus,
I know that my Jesus.